All praise the Creator, the eternal energy that we all seek. But some of us have a family tree, some of us have a lineage, and we all must come to a point to say, what's more important? What's more important, the lineage or the choice that you make? The intention that you put on your crystal.
You are the crystal. What intention are you going to put on it? What must you choose up from? We all have different variations of these, you know, so-called obstacles that we have to choose up, choose our vibration. It don't matter what you look like, you're gonna have to choose your vibration. And when we get into the indigenous truth, we realize, man, this is a family affair like a mofo. And all the bits and pieces of the puzzle will drop in front of you with clarity. With clarity of the family tree. We have to see our family. We have to see ourselves. We have to forgive each other. We have to know. Look, your current invader, your current oppressor just mumble jumbled and did a shuffle ball change, but your true history is a family tree, a family connection, a family, you know, either order or chaos, depending on how you look at it. And that's what we're going to bring out. That's what we're touching on today. This is, you know, hopefully only going to be a couple of parts. I'm not going to drag this out too long, but it might be two or three parts or so. Because, you know, I think it's right about on time. You know, we've been discussing separate elements of the Moabite connection. You know what I'm saying? The more connection, our connection, of us all being more, meaning great. But what meaning are we putting on these names, and what meaning are we putting on our own crystal? You could say, oh, well, you come from a seed of this hijack, you come from the seed of that hijack. Knowing all that, will you still choose up? You come from a family full of sun worshipers or Baal worshipers or this and this and that. Will you still choose up, or must you be from Israel? Must you be an Israelite to choose up? Must you have to go on with trying to prove yourself more than proving your creator? You're focusing on proving yourself. And it becomes a selfish journey. And you're like, yeah, well, I'm just getting all this information about me. And how much are you proving the creator, providing the evidence? What evidence are you providing? What proof are you providing? In your own actions, in your own crystal, what intention are you putting on your crystal? How are you crystallizing? These are choices that we have to make when we say choose up. Instead of pointing the fingers at who's an Ammonite, and who's a Moabite, and who's a Canaanite, and who's a this or that, and I must be a this, and my father must be a that, and we must look like this, and you must look like that. Everybody, prove the creator. Prove it through your actions. Those that are blind are blind. Those that can't see won't see. But what do your actions show? What do your actions prove? Are you just proving yourself? So I'm not going to go into a whole bashing session. This is not to bash my brothers anywhere on any walk in this journey, whether they're more or comedic science or, you know what I mean? It's all about not taking a higher than you approach. I never approached this as a scholar, but as a brother of you, you being a brother or sister of mine, us all asking the pertinent questions, the right questions at the right time. You know what I'm saying? It's like you get tired of the door being slammed in your face because you have a question or you want to look at a certain, you know, journey of this narrow path. So, you know, we're coming with the full, humility to know that, you know, we don't know. I don't know half of what these brothers is kicking in this temple or that temple or this. I told you from the jump. I know a lot about a little. I know a lot about a little. I know a little about a lot. All right. So that lot I know about a little, I'm doing my best to expose that. We're doing our best to drop that for everyone to get free right away. Take it. Take what you got because you're studying with us. We're all in the same classroom. I'm being taught every day by all these brothers and sisters. I mean, the brother Arthur Scott is just going through the races of men and just dropping so much pertinent drop. The brother Higher Mark is just cutting all through these Grand Canyons and all this indigenous truth from day one. Getting to the root of it all. Slicing all through, you know what I'm saying? These perceptions, this Hollywood, this energy. He's exposing all of this energy coming through what perception is being forced on you. The brother Isaac Ford is doing nothing but the investigation. Dropping extreme links at all time. AD the same. We're all coming with this indigenous feel. The brother Teach Me Tippy Priestley, you already know. Everyone's coming with this indigenous feel, and now we're applying the right things, the right energy at the right place with the right pulse, with the united pulse. We are a hive. We have a hive mentality. We're connected to the consciousness that you're surfing on. We're connected to the consciousness you're in. Now we have to know when we choose up what it is and what it ain't. And the exposure is a motherfucker. But we're going to have to get to the root of it all. Exodus 15, 1. Pull it up. Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto, they say, the Lord. We say the Creator, the Most High. Heya, heya. Hawa. And spake, saying, I will sing unto Heya, heya. For he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. The Most High, Hawa, is my strength and song. And he has become my salvation. He is my God, my power. I will prepare him an habitation, my father's God, and I will exalt him. Hawa is a man of war. Hawa is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his host hath he cast into the sea. His chosen captains also are drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sink into the bottom as a stone. The depths have covered them. They sank into the bottom as a stone. Emerald tablets. Tablet 1. Over the world then broke the great waters, drowning and sinking, changing earth's balance, until only the temple of light was left standing on the great mountain of Undal, still rising out of the water. Some there were who were living, saved from the rush of the fountains, called me then the master, saying, gather ye together my people, take them by the arts ye have learned as far across the waters until ye reach the land of the hairy barbarians. Now, this is the 18th dynasty, Thoth. Thutmose's born of Thoth. This is the sinking of Egypt, the sinking of Atlantis, documented in the Emerald Tablets, tablet number one. Some try to qualify this as a Noah story. Well, we're just talking about down through the ages I lived, seeing those around me taste of the cup of death. We're talking about death and return again in the light of life, light of life. So death to life, gradually from the kingdoms of Atlantis, Atlantis. Remember Atlantis, past waves of consciousness that had been one with me only to be replaced by spawn of a lower star. Gradually in the kingdoms of Atlantis, past waves of consciousness that had been one with me only to be replaced by spawn of a lower star. In obedience to the law, the word of the master grew into flower. Downward. Now, whose master is this? Whose master is this? Downward into the darkness turned the thoughts of the Atlanteans into that last. And this wrath arose from his Agwanti, the dweller. Who's the dweller? The dweller is their master. Who's the dweller? Lucifer, the dweller. Who's the dweller? The dweller is their master. The dweller is their Baal. The dweller is their Belus. Belus, Belus, Egyptian. Belus, Belus, Baal, Baal. You know, Greek mythology hijacked all of the Egyptian, which is the hijack of all of the Atlantean. A king of Egypt and father of Egyptus. And Danius, and usually brother of Agenor, the wife of Belus, has been named as Akero, or Sidi, C-D, as in Sidon, Phoenician city of Sidon. Belis founded a colony on the river Euphrates. Remember the river Euphrates in America. Belis was the son of Poseidon and Libya. Baal, Belis, Baal. The son of Poseidon and Libya. This is an archived genealogy in Greek mythology at frankenland.blogspot.com. We got so much drop out of this already and a lot more to get. You see Zeus here. Alright, so here's their land. Zeus. And there's a bunch of what you'll see Zeus pop up here. Zeus, Zeus. These are all the same Zeus impregnating different women in his family. Zeus and Io. You have Epaphus. Epaphus and Memphis. Memphis. Memphis has Libya. Libya and Poseidon then have Belus, whose wife here is Akero, just like they said. The children of Baal, 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 are Egyptus, Egypt. So you see, these are all, it's all connecting, it's all connecting. It's all coming together. Exodus 15. Let's go to verse 4. Pharaoh's chariots and his hosts hath he cast into the sea. Pharaoh, Egypt, cast into the sea by the Creator. His chosen captains also are drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank into the bottom as a stone. Again, Emerald Tablets, Tablet 1. Over the world then broke the great waters, drowning and sinking, changing earth's balance until only the temple of light was left, sinking on the great mountain of Undal, still rising out of the water, some there were who were living, saved from the rush of the fountains, called to me then the master, saying, gather ye together my people, take them by the arts ye have learned of far across the waters, until ye reach the land of the hairy barbarians, Barbaria, Tartaria. So then they went to what? Barbaria. I used to have a really good map at Modix. This might be it here. Let's see. Yeah, it's a little different than what I had. Maybe taking these links down, man. Tartaria. Okay, here we go. Tartaria. Now this is, you know, we also heard Tartaria and these Tartars, you know what I'm saying, connected to this South America situation. Now Tartaria is also Barbaria. You see where it's located? Barbaria. Let's look at map images of Barbaria. Rare maps. Let's look at this. You know, I'm a map guy. You know I like me maps. Barbaria. As you see Spain here, we're just talking North Africa. We're talking Africa. We're talking Libya. We're talking Barbaria. You see how this Barbaria is way over here where, you know what I'm saying, you have this Egypt situation and all that connected, Barbaria, all over here in this east, northeast situation. So we have back in Thoth, take them by the arts you have learned, their magic sciences, their Atlantean magic hijack sciences that they hijacked you with, Poseidon in them, Thoth in them, until ye reach the land of the hairy barbarians. Dwelling in caves of the desert, follow there the plan ye know of. So they went to the land of Barbaria, the land of the hairy barbarian, they're claiming. Barbary, Africa, Libya, Africa. This is a closer view of it, alright? Can I click it again? Oh, look at that. Barbaria. So just keep this in mind because you're not gonna all right, see this on the other side. All right, this is gonna be over here. Barbaria. You remember the, let's get this down. Let's get that down. Iborian war map is going to play as usual. As usual. And when you come over here, of course, this is the Pangaea situation. Again, you have Egypt here, Cam here. We're going to get into all that. Egypt is over here, over South America, over the Amazon. This is a reality simulation from Arizona. And when you come to the same land of Barbaria, they just have mountains of the mist. Utah, they call it Utah. Utah, Karoo. Remember the Al-Kabulan map that had all these in there, you know what I'm saying, Arabinia, you know what I mean? Then you got the Abyssinia situation, all right? So, you know, you don't got none of the, you know, so-called Kemet, all that over here at this time, this Vindhya, pretty much called India, Vindhya, all of it. But you have Barbaria covering this area right here. And again, all your real drop. All what's really going on with this Stygia, Luxor, Punt, Zimbabwe, all that is over here now. We just use this, you know, for fun because everything else is connecting to this, which is, you know, what we're surfing on. So we go to the land of Barbaria, the hairy barbarians dwelling in caves in the desert. Follow there the plan that ye know of. Gathered I then my people and entered the great ship of the master. So yeah, are we talking about Noah's Ark? You know, leaving, you know, spreading, you know what I'm saying? You know, saying these particular seeds, or are we talking about a ship with the master rising above the waters? A spaceship, a flying machine. This is not the Noah story. So, you know, because there's a flood going on, you know, it's been, you know, I've seen it hijacked as, oh yeah, you know, this is thought this Noah, you know, and all this kind of stuff. You're talking about a ship on the water. You're talking about a flying machine going to the land of hairy barbarians. And what does Thoth do? All right. And this is how you kill the whole, you know, Noah comparison right here. What does Thoth do? What does Thoth do when he enters the land of the barbarian? He says, "Fast we fled toward the sun of the morning." First, I mean, gathered I then my people into the great ship of the master. Upward we rose, so we were flying. We rose into the morning. Dark beneath us lay the temple. Suddenly over it rose the waters, vanished from the earth until the time appointed was the great temple. So the temples were covered. The Atlantean temples were covered. Pharaoh's chariots and his host hath he cast into the sea. He chose captains also. His chosen captains also were drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank into the bottom as a stone. Okay, you know, we're just trying to connect a couple of things before we go into a great video, man. That, you know, Isaac sat me down, and I'm glad that, you know what I'm saying, I'm able to really check it out and flow with it, man. Again, you know, I'm gonna take my time. I'm not gonna rush through this thing. I don't care how many parts it takes to get this out the right way. You know, that flows, you know what I mean? So fast we fled toward the sun of the morning until benefit beneath us lay the land of the children of Kim. All right, so now they're going to the land of the barbarian. All right, the barbarian, hairy barbarian, he said. And now he's saying the children of Kim. So now, again, that's confirmation from the Emerald Tablets that this barbarian is referring to Kim. Libya. How do we go again? How'd this go again? Zeus, Zeus, Ham, Zeus, Ham, Zeus, Ham, Lo, Epaphus, and Memphis have Libya. Poseidon and Libya have Baal, Bel, also known as Belus, Belus. Belus is not only talked about in the Egyptian pantheon, but also in the Babylonian pantheon, named Belus or Belos. In Babylonian context, refers to the Babylonian god Bel Marduk. Okay, Marduk, Marduk. All right, then also identified with the Greek Zeus. Yeah. Zeus Belos, Jupiter, Isus, Jesus. Ah, this energy, this thought frequency is all around us, Belus, the Zeus. So whether you are rocking Baal this way or that way, you're still rocking Zeus. You're still rocking Baal. 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 I don't know why that got me thinking, because we're getting into the whole more situation. And you have a lot of Bays and a lot of L's. Put them together, you have the Bay-L, Bell, Bell, Lego. Back to the Emerald Tablets. Alright, so fast we fled towards the sun of the morning until beneath us the land lay the land of the children of Kim. Raging, they came with cudgels and spears. So this sounds like some white person going into Africa for the first time, being attacked by these Africans with spears, right? No, this is Thoth. Oh yeah, you all worship Thoth. Thutmosis, born of Thoth. Eye of Ra, Mercury, also known as Hermes. Come on, man. Also known as Muhammad. But we're going to get there. Raging they came with cudgels and spears. Raging they came with cudgels and spears. Lifted in anger, seeking to slay and utterly destroy the sons of Atlantis. So these indigenous people of Barbaria, people of Kim, the indigenous people of Kim, saw these people as a hijack and came at them with weapons of war. Lifted in anger, seeking to slay and utterly destroy the sons of Atlantis. So they perceived, the indigenous people there, perceived these sons of Atlantis, Thoth, and then these Egyptians as hijacks. And thought to slay them. They thought they came, you know, cut them down. Then what did Thoth do? He said, then raised I my staff and directed a ray of vibration. Then raised I my staff and directed a ray of vibration, striking them still in their tracks as fragments of stone of the mountain. So Thoth, the leader of these sons of Atlantis, who hopped in this ship with the dweller when his temples were sinking by the creator, and came over here to Barbaria, found the children of Kim, who saw them as a hijack, tried to kill Thoth and them, but Thoth raised his staff, directed a ray of vibration, striking them still in their tracks as fragments of stone of the mountain. From that point on, you were hijacked, baby, by Thoth. Then spoke I to them in words calm and peaceful. Remember, they come in peace, but he already struck them to stone with a slave vibration, a ray of vibration. Oh, you don't think it's a slave vibration? If I turn you into stone and start talking all up in your ear real soft, and I done turned your ass into stone first, do I mean peace? Did Thoth mean peace? Does Thoth mean peace? Does the dweller mean peace? For you, indigenous person, wake up out of the spell, all of my brothers and sisters. Again, we trying to get, you know, we surfing a wave. We surfing an energy. We awakening to an energy. We just sharing it. We ain't combating nobody. We just sharing it. That's it. That's it. We just sharing it. Then raised I my staff and directed a ray of vibration, says Thoth, striking them still in their tracks as fragments of stone of the mountain. Then spoke I to them in words calm and peaceful, telling them of the might of Atlantis. So he brainwashed you while you were stone and told you about how mighty they were in Atlantis and all these, you know, dynasties. And then you wanted that same thing ever since. You wanted the shiny shit. You didn't want the creator. You just wanted yourself. But you lost yourself when you were turned into stone. And you have to come out of her. You have to come out of the spell of the might of Atlantis, which is why it's no more. You think I'm the only one talking Atlantis? Stay tuned. Saying we were children of the sun and his messengers, coward I them. Coward I them. He made you cowards, trembling. Coward I them by my display of magic science. Wow. By his spell, Thoth spell barrier. Oh, you don't think Thoth has a spell barrier? Thoth Amon spell barrier right here in South America. Thoth Amon spell barrier underneath Stygia, which is Egypt. And you see Kim right here. Luxor right here. Uh-oh. Let go. So check it. Then I spoke to them with calm words. He told them about the might of Atlantis. Coward I them by my display of magic science. While you were turned to stone, he did his magic science. Coward you until at my feet they groveled. You're still groveling at Thoth's feet. Get it? Is this your God, or do you have a creator? Does your God need to turn you into stone? Would you come at your God with a spear? Would you perceive in your indigenous mind your God to be a hijack? That's what they did with these mighty men of Atlantis, these Egyptians. Iptos, Egypt, Iptos, Eptos, Eptas, son of Baal, Belas, son of Belas, son of Murdoch, son of Jupiter, Zeus Belos, Egypt, Thoth, Zeus, dweller, fallen angel, celestial, underneath the firmament, the barrier, all right? Barrier and firmament is firmament. That's a new damn word, and you're going to have to dig on it. Get with it or get left on. Underneath the firmament, man. All right? So cowered I then by my display of magic science until at my feet they groveled when I released them. When he released you, you were groveling at his feet, and you haven't stopped, so-called Negro, so-called Moor, so-called this, so-called that. Oh, Kemet, Kemetic sciences, brother. Well, in Kemet, he turned you into stone and had you groveling at his feet while he did his display of magic science on you. And now you're all about the sciences, brother, of Thoth, brother. Long dwelt we in the land of Kim, long and yet long again, until obeying the commands of the master, the dweller master, Lucifer, who while sleeping yet lives eternally. But he's sleeping, but he lives, but he's sleeping, but he lives. I sent from me the sons of Atlantis, sent them in many directions, that from the womb of time, wisdom might rise again in her children. So now he's just talking about his peoples that he's doing the magic sciences on, man. I mean, you think I'm the only one talking about Atlantis? MorrisScienceTemple.org. We're going to get into this, but let's just go. Noble Drew Ali. Noble Drew Ali. Love to the fam band. Love to all the fam. I mean, we're just asking questions and, you know, digging on it. Don't mind us. All right. Noble Drew Ali explains two portions of history in the Holy Quran of the Moorish Science Temple of America, chapter 45 and 48. All right, so they say the prophet informs us that, quote, so we're quoting Noble Drew Ali. All right, let go. The inhabitants of Africa are the descendants of the ancient Canaanites from the land of Canaan. Old man Cush and his family are the first inhabitants of Africa who came from the land of Canaan. Let's go. His father Ham and his family were second. Then came the word Ethiopia, the Greek word, right? Which means the demarcation line of the dominion of Amexum. I want to go there, but we'll get there. Remember, Amexum. And the first true and divine name of Africa, Amexum. Interesting. The dividing of the land between the father and the son. Interesting. The dominion of Cush, northeast and southeast Africa, and northwest and southwest, was the father's dominion of Africa. In later years, many of their brethren from Asia and the Holy Lands joined them. Interesting. The Moabites from the land of Moab, who received permission from the pharaohs of Egypt to settle, so they had a alliance with the pharaohs of Egypt, which makes sense when we talk about this Thoth thing, because Thoth is Muhammad. Thoth is Thutmosis. Thoth is running the whole board, can't you see? You're all under the sciences of Thoth. But, you know, we're just asking questions. So, the Moabites from the land of Moab, who received permission from the pharaohs of Egypt to settle and inhabit northwest Africa, they were founders and are the true possessors of the present Moroccan Empire. From Moab, the Moabites. Got it. Got it. The Moabites from the land of Moab received permission from these pharaohs in Egypt. Right. All right. So, if this is Egypt, just like they're pulling all the artifacts out the Grand Canyon, just like, all throughout Illinois, you're getting all this connection to Egypt here, Atlantis here, and Moab is also Moab, Utah, Udall here. Then we have Egypt and Moab here. So let's just connect this, you know what I'm saying? Because that's what we're supposed to do. Now, I said we ain't the only ones talking Atlantis. Thoth and them, how does this connect to Noble Drew Ali? What does he say about this connection between the Moors and Moabites, the land of Moab and Atlantis? The Moabites from the land of Moab, who received permission from the pharaohs of Egypt to settle and inhabit northwest Africa. They were the founders and the true possessors of the present Moroccan Empire with their Canaanite, Hittite, and Amorite brethren. Amorite, Amorite, Morocco, Moab with their Canaanite, Hittite, Amorite brethren who sojourn from the land of Canaan seeking new homes. See, they are embracing their family tree. They're truly embracing their history, and you can't knock them for that. It's up to us to choose up. Their dominion and inhabitation extended from northeast and southwest Africa across Great Atlantis. Across Great Atlantis. Yeah, man. Barbaria. Barbaria. Atlantis. Don't you play. Where's my Atlantis, don't y'all mess with me, man. Atlantis, Atlantis. Where's my map? This is it. Y'all, oh, wait. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Whew. I almost thought I lost my map, man. This map, man, has been. We've been surfing the wave with this for a long time. So, I get a little. A little emotional about my maps. All right, Atlantis, a land that once connected what they're calling, America, Amorica, Morocco, Moroccan. This was a colony of this Barbaria situation, this north, I'm saying west Morocco, this situation here colonized that situation here. This was West Africa, because they considered this West Africa, a West colony of their colony here. And I say, well, who gave you this one world empire? Moab. Oh, Moab, I mean, Moab, you're doing treaties, Moab. Transfer of inheritance to the Moors of North Amexum. Where do we see this in Amexum? Where do we see this in Amexum? Noble Drew Ali. He just said the dominion of Amexum, the first and true divine name of Africa. Well, now we're talking about North Amexum, so we're talking about North Africa, North America. So they want Africa and America. I mean, all that belongs to Moab, right? North Gate. Remember, this was signed by Zelia S. Bey. Excuse me, Zelia S. L. Bayal L. All right. Aboriginal, Indigenous, National, Moorish, American. Harris. Empress. Moabite. We caught this a long time ago, this Moabite. And why is there a Moabite here? We're talking about something signed, what, 1430? Huh? And then it looked like it was updated in 2010. Originally signed in 1430. What was going on in 1430? So-called Negro. See, if you don't know who you are, you's probably on the other side of this. You know what I'm saying? You have your cousins that look just like you, but yeah, they're not you. And so they benefit off of your ignorance, and they do treaties For who? Moab. For land and resources at latitude, longitude, 41, da 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 da. All this Connecticut, you know what I'm saying? You got all this area, this East Coast area that they're getting. Zelia S.L. signing as a Moabite, transferring inheritance. She's protected under all this. All the Zodiac Constitution protects the United States Republic, Department of Justice, United States Supreme Court, Supreme Laws protecting them. This transfer involves her inalienable, secure rights as a Moorish American national, secure under all these declarations, executive orders. Remember Tripoli. Remember the Barbaria treaties. 1786, Treaty of Peace and Friendship. We'll get more of this later. November 4th, 1796, Treaty of Peace and Friendship signed in Tripoli. Alright? There is firm and perpetual peace and friendship between the United States Corporation and the Bay, subjects of Tripoli, Barbary, Bellas Bay, made by the free consent of both parties and guaranteed by the most potent Dey and Regency of Algiers. If goods belong to any nation with which either of the parties is at war, shall be loaded on board any vessels belonging to the other party, they shall pass free. So if the corporation went to war against you, they have to go with it. They couldn't go against it. By going against it, they're violating the Treaty of Peace and Friendship between them and the corporation. So they only exist in the corporation. They get their power from the corporation. Sure, Morocco predates this corporation, but they still get their power because this corporation took over, at least on paper. I mean, my man Uno is dropping about that Boule. So we're getting this out of, you know, the Emerald Tablets of Thoth. These Tablet 1, you got the links, pull it up. He's talking about Atlantis. Noble Drew Ali's talking about Atlantis. He's talking about the Moabites from the land of Moab. All right. Receive permission from the pharaohs to settle there. Alright, so these Moabites. The dominion and inhabitation extended from northeast and southwest Africa across Great Atlantis, even unto present North, South, and Central America, and also Mexico, and the Atlantis Islands before the earthquake, which caused the Great Atlantic Ocean. Oh yeah. Noble Drew Ali know a lot about Atlantis. Noble Drew Ali speak Atlantis very well. He knows about the unnavigable waters when this sunken island sunk. He ensure he knows about this island, you know, this land that connected Australia to India and Lemuria from Australia to the other side of America. There's more land. More land, sunken all over the place. All over the place. So this brother Noble Drew Ali, you know what I'm saying? I mean, this is their prophet. He's bringing them, he's reestablishing their law. He's reestablishing Thoth. He's reestablishing Moab. He is a prophet to Moab. Is he a prophet to Israel? He's a prophet to Moab. He's a prophet to Canaan. Is he a prophet to Israel? And if Moab exists and Canaan exists, surely the sons of Jacob and daughters of Jacob exist. Surely we do. We just don't know who the hell we are. We're called Negro. We accept it because we don't have that family connection. All of our chiefs have been destroyed. But they have their chiefs. They have their chiefs. So we'll get back into this Noble Drew Ali. You know what I'm saying? You know, we started with this Exodus. We're talking about the floods. Let's go right here. And the right hand of Heya, Heya, Hawa is become glorious in power. Thy right hand, Hawa, hath dashed in pieces the enemy. Ah, the enemy was dashed in pieces. And in the greatness of thine excellency, thou hast overthrown them that rose up against thee. Thou sentest forth thy wrath, which consumed them as stubble, And with the blast of thy nostrils, the waters were gathered together. The flood stood upright as an heap, and the depths were congealed in the hearts of the sea. The enemy said, I will pursue, I will overtake, I will divide the spoil. My lust shall be satisfied upon them. I will draw my sword, my hand shall destroy them. Thou didst blow with the wind, the sea covered them. They sink as lead in the mighty water. They sank as lead in the mighty water. They sank as lead in the mighty water and went where? Barbaria. Set up shop. Thoth vibration. He says he gave them soul force. Raise them up to do what? Go against the indigenous. Now they have an army hopping with Columbus, coming over here talking about they discovering something. Dark Portuguese, dark swarthy Spaniards, Moorish Columbus. But Moor means great, but they came to conquer the greatness so that the name of Israel will be in remembrance no more. So that you will be Psalms 83 right quick. A confederacy formed against you. Let's keep going. Again, we're in Exodus 15, verse. Let's go verse 10. Thou didst blow with the wind, the sea covered them. They sank as lead in the mighty waters. Who is like unto thee, Hawa, among the gods? Who is like thee, glorious in holiness, fearful in praising, doing wonders? Thou stretchest out thy right hand, the earth swallowed them. Thou is thy mercy, has led forth the people which thou hast redeemed. Thou hast guided them in thy strength unto thy holy habitation. Where's the habitation? Huh? Are they doing treaties for your habitation? The people shall hear and be afraid. Sorrow shall take hold of the inhabitants of Palestina. Then the dukes of Edom shall be amazed. Then the mighty men of Moab, trembling, shall take hold upon them. All the inhabitants of Canaan shall melt away. Fear and dread shall fall upon them. Exodus 15:15. So, you know, Moab wants to spin this and say, look, man, you know, that's just a flip, you know what I mean? Like, you know, white man told y'all to, you know, that, you know, saying that to put y'all against us and it's all about this and that. If you were a Moabite, then you have fathers. And if you have fathers, we have fathers. And if our fathers are Moab, hey, I could be a Moabite. I'm not over here just to bash Moabites. I could be a Canaanite. I'm not over here to bash Canaanites. But what frequency are you in? Can I be a Moabite that chooses up? Can you be a Moabite that chooses up? Meaning choose the reality, not what Thoth put on you, not the spell that had you cowered. Cowered I then by my display of magic. Science, magic, alchemy, chemistry, chem, science, magic, coward I with this vibration. Lifted in anger, seeking to slay and utterly destroy the sons of Atlantis, then raised I my staff and directed a ray of vibration. I told you it's a frequency war. What frequency are you in? You have to choose a frequency, choose a vibration. And if you find your vibration leads back to Thoth, leads back to the dweller who had you cowered with his display of magic science until at my feet they groveled when I released them. That he had you groveling while he turned you into stone. Is that the frequency you serve? You're going to have to choose up. I'm not getting this out the white man's book. I'm getting this out the Emerald Tablets. Okay. So that's a couple of, that's basically our intro. That's basically our intro. Exodus 15:15. Then the dukes of Edom shall be amazed. The mighty men of Moab, trembling, shall take hold of them. Trembling will Moab be when the frequency, when the energy is exposed. Because they can only go back to Baalis. They can only hope that Baal, their father, their seed, whatever they want to go back to, is really truly going to be a savior, a true savior. What is a savior? Saving your ass from destruction. Saving your ass from destruction. Just look for the sunken continents if you don't know what I'm talking about. Just look at what's popping right now if you don't know what I'm talking about. And this cry out is for all of my family to come up out of her, the frequency that was sunk, the frequency that hopped in a flying ship with the dweller to come put these people under a slave vibration so that they today are all in other frequencies, all in other energies, all in the celestial and not with the creator. And they don't know what's the jam up, what's the problem. But the mighty men of Moab, trembling shall take hold upon them, and all the inhabitants of Canaan shall melt away. For this reason, let's go. And all the inhabitants of Canaan shall melt away with their Canaanite, Hittite, Amorite brethren who sojourn from the land of Canaan seeking new homes. Brethren, old man Cush and his family, first inhabitants of Africa, came from the land of Canaan, ancient Canaanites, the Moabites with their Canaanite, Hittite, and Amorite brethren. We're going to paint the whole picture. We're going to paint the picture like we never painted the picture before. And now with that premise, we can get into, we got to paint. We have to, be on our own. You know what I'm saying? Take our own easel and do our thing. Because we've been given images all this time. So I'm not going to rush this to try to fit it into one part. I'm going to give it to you if it takes seven parts. Because I'm going to do my best. As you do your best in Drop Nation, everywhere you go, fighting the hijack, I give that to you. You know what I mean? And again, we're just coming out of, their prophet, their Moabite prophet. And that's not disrespectful. That's love. You know what I'm saying? I get it. He's raising his nation. But we have to be conscious of ours. And that's what we are becoming, conscious of the wave that we're swimming in and what we represent. But let's go. Let's go. First of all, first of all, fair use on that ass, man. Fair use on your caboose. You know what I mean? We are just doing some criticism, some comment, some news reporting, some teaching, some scholarship, and some research. Fair use is a use permitted by the copyright statute that might otherwise be infringing non-profit educational and personal use tips. The balance in favor of fair use. Get up off me. Let go. Let go. Let go. I mean, we're just talking Moab. We're just talking an ancient battle. At the time of, this is from the Jewish Encyclopedia.com. Get babies out of this. At the time of the Hebrew invasion, the Moabites seemed to have been so powerful that conflict with them was avoided, although the Israelites defeated and slew Sihon, the Amorite king of Heshbon. So you see, at the time of your invasion, the Moabites seemed to have been so powerful. So powerful. Moab, on the other hand, under its king Balak, meditated a resistance to the invaders, which it dared not carry out. After the conquest, the Moabite territory was allotted to the tribe of Reuben. All right, you see all the scriptures there. The Moabites seem to have been submitted to the control of the Hebrews for a time. So these Hebrews, these so-called Hebo, Negro, Ebos, love to Isaac, man, talking about, you know, our family, you know, the Ebos in West Africa and the connection, you know what I'm saying? They've been over there fighting because they're not from there. They're from here. This tribe that was taken from the Americas and dropped off over there, subjugated over there, been fighting over there the whole time because they're from here. Yeah, I said it. Dig on it. Now, the Moabites seem to have been submitted to the control of the Hebrews for a time. So this is a family affair of these Hebo Negroes, Hebo Negro, that is now having their Moabite family under submission. King of Moab, so until Eglon, king of Moab, with the help of the Ammonites and the Amalekites. All right, so you got their connection to Mount Seir and Edom. They were rocking with Edom, succeeded in conquering them and ruled them 18 years. So then the Moabites raised back up under this king of Moab and then ruled for 18 years. And at the end of this period, a Benjamite named Ehud obtained access to Eglon and treacherously assassinated him. So again, you had this family affair, Hebrews and Moab. Hebrews and Moab. Why do they consider this Amorica? Because they are colonizing Hebrews. That's why they call it Muslim Jerusalem, even though we know through Let Us Find the Truth that this Muslim etymology just means a people who are submitting to a promise or promised land. But their sultan was not, you know what I'm saying, rock with, Prester John didn't rock with the sultan, didn't rock with Islam, didn't rock with Darius and these Persians and all this more Moab situation. King David didn't rock with this, but they want us to think that we're in some black hole and we're all just, we're all Moors here. We're all from this colony here. But King David didn't rock with this. Our lineage didn't rock with this. Jerusalem didn't rock with this. They hijacked it. At the end of this period, a Benjamite named Ehud obtained access to Eglon and treacherously assassinated him, whereupon the Hebrews arose and slaughtered 10,000 Moabites. In Judges 3, the Hebrews arose and slaughtered 10,000 Moabites. A few years later, Saul waged a war, apparently of little importance, against them and their allies. King David, let Nathaniel DeWitt, also known as Prester John, Prester Y, Priest King. We'll get back there. You know, we got part 25 coming up. Love to everybody that's taking the time to surf that wave. I know it's a lot of information, you know, but we're enjoying it. You know what I'm saying? And I don't care if you're on part 12 or part 2. Take your time with it, man. And just swim that water, man. Keep swimming that water. And keep, you know, giving us the drive, man. Give us your drive. Share your drive. All right. We're getting there. We're almost done with the intro. Man, this is just the intro. So, alright, so we have Moab, alright, Balak, we have the Moab seems to have submitted to these Hebrews. The Hebrews arose and slaughtered 10,000 Moabites. A few years later, Saul waged a war, apparently of little importance, against them and their allies. David, King David, Prester John, King David, also subdued them and made them tributary. Didn't we just read that Prester John had all these kings paying tributary unto him, 72 kings? Didn't he say that the Sultan also paid him tribute? So their Sultan is their Sultan of Moab, who paid tribute to King David. Why? Because they were going back and forth. It was a war. Hebrews arose and slaughtered 10,000 Moabites. This is all this stuff that we're reading about, that we're thinking is over there, is happening here. David also subdued them and made them tributary. This is happening in America. This is happening in Moab. This is happening in America. Although it is noteworthy that even before this time, a Moabite named Itmah was one of his generals. After the death of Ahab, the Moabites under Mesha rebelled against Joram, who allied with Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and with the king of Edom. At the direction of Elisha, the Israelites dug a series of ditches between themselves and the enemy. All right, so this is Israelites, Moabites, Hebrews, Moabites, sons of Jacob against Ammon, Moab, and all that. And what did you get out of Psalms 83? These people are making confederacies against you, your own family. Man, it's deeper than the white man. It's your own family. What's the boule today? Who's these messianic, you know what I'm saying, situations going on today? What's the connection with the Masons and the Moor situation? The Masons and the Moor situation, the Moabite situation, Baal situation, Moab situation. According to Genesis, what's that, 19, verse 30, Moab was the son of Lot by his elder daughter. So Lot and his daughter made Moab. Thus is their lineage. Now they may deny all this, but this is the lineage of these people who are Moabites. The Moabites from the land of Moab. The Moabites from the land of Moab. They're signing treaties, and on their treaties they say Moabite. Genesis 1930. Moab was the son of Lot by his elder daughter, while Ammon was Moab's half brother by a similar union of Lot with his younger daughter. Elder daughter had a baby named Moab. Younger daughter had a baby named Ammon. So the Ammonites and Moabites always rocked together, and they had their alliances with the other, you know what I'm saying, Edomites, the Amalekites, the inhabitants of Mount Seir. We're just talking Edom. All right, we're just talking Edom. So with that premise, man, let's start our investigation into this drop. I'm gonna start here with this 3-minute clip by my man Brooklyn Magi. You know what I'm saying? We're gonna get the babies out. You know what I'm saying? We're just gonna play. We're gonna be hijack free. We're gonna know we are we. All right, so we're gonna surf the wave. Man, that was a 1-hour intro into this series. So we're gonna get this. We're gonna start our drop, man, with Prince Uriel Bey. Again, love to the brother Isaac Ford, man, for sitting me down, man, at the crib and being like, man, dig on it, man. So I'm grateful to get that, man. So thank you, brother. And all the fans rocking, Drop Nation, you already know. Love to Catrice Green, staying hijack free for real, cancer free for real. Love to Jace doing the try, let go. All right, surf the wave, y'all.
People gonna call them Islam, but I'm gonna call it the Moors. They were created. Baphomet was given.
Let's just get going. Let's go. Let's go.
Baphomet actually was created by, people gonna call them Islam, but I'm gonna call it the Moors. They were created. Baphomet was given, or the teachings, or the secrets of Baphomet and the secrets of brotherhood and all this stuff were given to the Knights Templar by the Moors. The Knights Templar learned from the Moors the ways of brotherhood, brotherly love, how to, the secret society things that we see today.
And just the wave we're surfing kind of has that, or does have that, flipped the other way around, in the sense that the Templars connecting to the House of Andros and the Clan Ross, and you know what I'm saying, just the original ones that are keeping the secrets of Solomon's Temple and those things, like the Ark of the Covenant, which were not the Moors, but were who they were also calling Moor, More, meaning great, that were also referred to as the kings of Jerusalem. So these Moors and those Moors were all called Moors by the scribes, but were not calling themselves Moors. The kings of Jerusalem were not calling themselves Moors. But we got earlier, with the Knights Templar drop, the Prestigeon drop, that connection, could be a more pure water connection, you know what I'm saying? But we're just asking questions. And that the Moors, or this section, or this segment of them, were actually coming out or learning or branching out of these original Templars, which were Israelites. So I'm connecting more of the original Templars being Israelites, protecting Solomon's temple, protecting the Ark of the Covenant, and this more thing hijacking that, as it seems to do whenever it's convenient, because more is such a general term. But let's go.
Basically came from the Moors through the Knights Templar. Like, the Moors used the Knights Templars as agents to spread this throughout Europe, and it worked to this day. It's still around. The secret societies is what runs, you know, it's the big dogs that run the show.
Right, so to go from Templar to secret societies run the show, you know, it's like, it's a big leap, you know what I'm saying? The Templars were the Templars. Skull and Bones are Skull and Bones. You know, they're all protecting some particular secrets at hand, but one thing is not exactly the same. But let's go, man, let's go.
And this was all set out and started by black folks. I know it sounds crazy, but it is what it is. The Moors gathered certain members of the, you know, the Knight community and taught them certain secrets and, you know, told them how that it was, you know, that they have to die. That's why a lot of the Knights Templars were killed, because they would.
Now, I like what he just said in terms of the Moors gathered. Let's get that again. He says certain segments are parts of the Knight community, which means that they did not start this original Templar drop, but they gathered some Templars, which then Prester John has a letter talking about, you know, don't forget to destroy the treacherous Templars. So they are Templars, and then there's treacherous Templars. You know, he was at war against the Sultan and them. So may he be referring to these treacherous Templars that was recruited by these so-called Moors. Let's get that part again. Interesting.
Certain members of the, you know, the gathered certain members of the, you know, the,
let's get that.
It's the big dogs that run the show. And this was all set out and started by black folks. I know it sounds crazy, but it is what it is. The Moors gathered certain members of the, you know, the Knight community and taught them certain secrets and, you know, told them how that it was, you know, that they have to die. That's why a lot of the Knights Templars were killed, because they wouldn't give the secrets up. You see what I'm saying? That the Moors taught them. And, you know, it spread like wildfire, and it was too late. And, you know, to this day, we have them same secret societies around. Another thing is, when you go at the original meaning of Baphomet, before we get into the 1800s meaning of it, mm-hmm. You got to go back like 1,000 years or so, not 200 years to the 1800s. You got to go back like 1,000 years or so, and you'll see that the original name for Baphomet was Muhammad.
Stop. I mean, I don't even know where to go. I mean, let's go.
You gotta go back like 1,000 years or so, and you'll see that the original name for Baphomet was Muhammad. Showing you the Moorish Islam.
While modern scholars and the Oxford English Dictionary state that the origin of the name Baphomet, I need to get the
Islamic connection right there to it. You see what I'm saying? And this is why he was killed. This is why a lot of the temples were killed, for secretly worshiping the teachings of Muhammad. Not modern teaching neither. You know, the teachings was different. Back then, it had a lot of esoteric stuff involved in it. And
hold up, man. I need to get this, because part of that part is cut off. So this is called a separate window. Let's spell it like they spell it. Mohammed. How you spell Baphomet? I don't even know. Baphomet. I want to get that article that this dude is in. So I'm going to try this Wikipedia drop. Oh, man. Did we get it right away? Oh, man. Did we get it right away? Oh, man. All right. Baphomet is a term originally used to describe an idol or other deity that the Knights Templar were accused of worshiping. Was it all of them, or was these the treacherous Templars? Treacherous Templars. Let's go. Where's the Muhammad? Yeah, I want to get the one that he has. Might be further down. Let's see. There's a deity, demon, and or symbolic icon which originated in the 14th century. Keyword. As a supposed figure of worship of the Knights Templars. Supposed, accused, treacherous Templars. In those accounts, Baphomet was described as an inscribed head or human skull. The name Baphomet originally was a deformation of the name Muhammad, the prophet of Islam. Body bag, Daniel's son. Man, I don't know what else to tell you, but I'm going to let them tell you. Baphomet, their deity, demon, Baal, Baal. The name Baphomet originally was a deformation, a deformed, broken down version of Muhammad, the prophet of Islam. Then claims that the Templars were worshiping Baphomet meant, in fact, that they were secret Muslims if they were worshiping Baphomet. But who are these treacherous Templars? I don't know if it's going to pop up, man. Let's just try it. Treacherous Templars. Prester John, I mean, you see, I'm just doing this in front of you, man. So, you know, some of the links I got, some, you know, I just remember searching for, you know, whatever I was searching for. Yeah. Mysteries of the Templars. This looks familiar. Let's see what this says. Talking about a letter from the priest king, Prester John. There he is. An abominated idol. Baphomet. I'm even trying to link him to the Templar. Alright. They bestow worship in the chapter on the heathen idol, variously described as to physical characteristics, but known as Baphomet, which etymologically was the same word as Muhammad. Really? I mean, is this a stretch? Etymologies. I mean, I want to get to this video, man. This is all the intro. This is all the intro. But look, I mean, are you serious? Baphomet. Baphomet. I spell that right. Baphomet. I spell Baphomet. Baphomet. Tells you how much I give a shit about Baphomet. How do you spell Baphomet? Yeah, I thought I did. Alright. Trying to get some drop out of this etymologies. But it's not giving me nothing. Alright. So, I'm just trying to check these etymologies. Alright, but known as Baphomet, which etymologically was one of the same word as Muhammad. Alright, bear with me. Once or twice, the form Muhammad is actually used by witnesses in the trial, like so many persecuted heretical groups of the past. They were said to hold their chapters only secretly and at night. Alright, so. Alright, I'm gonna get this Prester John. situation. That's where we came from. Oh, Prester John. So we got Hughes de Payen. Remember, that's the founder of the Templar, which we're connecting. We're connecting. Prester John. Now they're going to say deep into Africa, this Prester John. But, you know, I just want to get to it. I don't want to turn this into a thing. But here's the quote. Prester John's letter also contained a warning against the Templars. Which Templars? Who were believed to be allied with his brother against him. Prester John's brother against him. Are we talking about the same Genghis Khan situation? The Tartars? Are we talking about the Cariot Mongols? Warning against which Templars, which are holding this secret, that are allied against, have been allied with his brother against. So whoever is allying against him is treacherous. He's not saying that the Templars are treacherous, but that whoever is allied against him are committing treachery against him. He says there are Frenchmen among you and your lineage, of your lineage and from our retinue, who hold with the Saracens. You confide in them and trust in them. That they, so is this Saracen, is he referring to the other band of Moors? The so-called Morocco Moors, the Treaty Moors? I don't know. Who hold with the Treaty Moors? Let's just insert that. Who hold with the Treaty Moors, who are allied with the Treaty Moors. You confide in them and trust them and that they should and will help you, but they are false and treacherous. These Saracens or Treaty Moors, may you be brave and of great courage and pray. Do not forget to put to death those treacherous Templars, those Treaty Moor Templars. These are the Moors that the brother's talking about, Brooklyn Magi. These are the Templars the brother's talking about, the Brooklyn Magi. These are the Baphomet, Baal, the treacherous Templars. And that's Prester John. And this is King David, Prester John. El Prester Juan, Emperor de los Abyssinios, Abyssinia, later called Ethiopia. America is Ethiopia. Before it was called Abyssinia, Ethiopia. It's a region, an area. And with that, I am ready. Let's finish this out. Let's go.
You know, it just wasn't straight up cut and dry religion how it is today. Put it like that. And that's why the church was mad and got rid of the Templars or whatever. And, you know, the image of Baphomet that we see today, it was drawn by, I think, what's the guy named? Something Levi. I'm going to put it up there. Eli Levi, something like that. He drew this picture of Baphomet. Or he drew this picture of the Sabbatical goat or something, part of my, you know, if I get it wrong, but the goat and all that. And then they put the name Baphomet on it. Before the 1800s, that wasn't really connected to the word Baphomet. You see what I'm saying? But modern occultists connected it. You know what I mean? Because it did have something to do with it a little bit, but they put their own extra spin on it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like a lot of people do when they get this stuff. They put their own spin on it, you okay. know, to fit their agenda or their plan. But that's just a quick breakdown.
Yeah.
You feel me? But thanks all for right. watching. Like, comment, subscribe, share this video. Peace.
Hey, man. Love to the bro, man. Love to you, bang. Love to you, bro. So, yeah, they put their spin on it. I can definitely dig on that. You know what I'm saying? That's why we have to stop spinning and stand firm, fixed, and immovable. And we're only talking about, again, this Baphomet deity, demon, originated in the 14th century. So, yeah, a spin is being put around this time for sure. Now, the name Baphomet originally, now we're talking about the original breakdown, was a deformation of the name Muhammad, the prophet of Islam. Alright, so remember this prophet of Islam's coming around with this saying, what, 700s? The 700s? Not too much of a difference. We're talking about a few hundred years. 200 years between here and here. All right, so, all right. After that, now we can begin the show. Now we can begin the show. So sit back. This is a 2-hour drop, and I am going to try to cover all of it. So again, it might be 4 parts, 5 parts, 7 parts. I don't know, but we're just going to get through it. And love again to the home team.
Brothers, just, you know,
let's sit back and hey, enjoy.
You. Okay, brother, you are. All right, guy, get up against the wall. Let me see some ID, guy. They kill me with that. Yeah.
Go ahead, Bob.
Oh, it's on?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. All right, good evening.
We're live, baby.
Coming
let's
to
go.
You. Live from Urus, or Buffalo, New York, and from the Moorish American Society of Comprehensive Science, also known as the Moorish Society of Atmaurium, the Talismanic Kingdom of Atmaurium. Let's see. Again, as I said, we talked about a lot of things yesterday about the United States. I know that's one of the areas of interest that our sister Bird Lockett has concerning the beginnings of the United States Corporation, in and throughout the continental United States, i.e. the Americas. And but in order to comprehend the myriad of actual events in and throughout the Americas, and the Moorish Empire on a whole, or to have an accurate anecdotal account, we must look and explore the events of the planetary and galactical conditions involving Mars, Earth, and the days of Atlantis. Now, of course, a lot of people will...
Atlantis plays, whether it's Noble Drew Ali or our brother Prince Uriel Bey. Bey, the Bays, right? So, really, Atlantis plays. Now, you heard him mention Mars, and I believe he probably thinks the Earth is a sphere, and he's spinning on a ball. And whenever that happens, you know, we just have to, hang in there. But, again, this is the combination that's coming together. When you're firm, you're fixed, man. But he's going to mention Mars, and, I guess allude to, I guess them coming from Mars, or us coming from Mars, or Moors are from Mars. All right. So, hang with it. Let's go.
Last, well, what does that have to do with the United States? It has a lot to do with it. When we look at the events and things which occurred in Atlantis some 16,000, 20,000 years ago, and even a million years ago, we can better comprehend and have an overall comprehension of exactly what occurred, or shall I say the cause and effect of ultimately what happened in the continental United States. So we then consider early Atlantis, Kemet, Axis, consciousness, grid changes, Eschaic logometers, which is another way of saying Akashic records, lifelines of those Akashic records, Moorish talismanic thaumaturgy. Thaumaturgy is basically another term that's used for magic or ancient magic.
Magic sciences.
We're also going to look at the science of ancestral incantations involving thaumaturgy, utilizing specific tones and language or languages of light. We're going to look at genealogy as well as true geography. Now, I know that is a lot, but as I said, all of these things relate directly and indirectly to the history and the origins of the United States Corporation and why it was formed, etc. But as I said, going back to the time of Atlantis, when we look at about 20,000 years ago, there was a process that occurred that involved the Moors of Atlantis at that time. You also had Moors on Mars, and
whoa.
You also had Moors who were living underground at that time. These were...
Whoa, you can't just skate over Mars, man. There's Moors on Mars. So what if Mars is a wandering star and not an actual terra firma planet? And planet means plain. Planet means flat. Planet means a spread flat surface, a plane. Planet comes from plane. So are we talking about the celestial connected plane that is connecting a sky area called Mars? I mean, everything plays. Let's go.
Masters, ascended masters from the sixth dimension. And I'll talk more about them in a minute. But the Moors that were actually living on Atlantis at that time, unfortunately, were involved in some experiments similar to that of the Philadelphia experiment.
Sorry, I just got this crazy thought in my head when I was thinking about Baylis. Baylis, Baylis, Belus, Belzeus. Murdoch. Son of Poseidon in Libya. Zeus Belus. Belus and Bel Merduk, Merdok, Merduk. Common Northwest Semitic title, Baal. All right, so Belus and Baal, which connects, of course, to their Zeus or god of war. And he just said that Moors were on Mars, and Mars is also called the god of war. So that actually does connect, that Moors are from this celestial connected sky area that is also from their god of war. Whether they're going Egyptian, Babylonian, Mars, it's all about the god of war. It's all about Thoth. It's all about the dweller. It's all about the dweller and the ship going to the hairy barbarians, right? Putting that magic science on you. The slave vibration. Listen how it connects. Listen how they, you know, big up this Atlantis hijack. Listen how they big up the Moabite connection, which is the Baal connection, the Baphomet connection, the Muhammad connection, the Sultan connection. And I ask you, did you rock with this Sultan? Or did you rock with King David? What tribe, what lineage, what power did you rock with? The celestial or that which is above the barrier, the firmament? Let's go.
In the 40s, involving time travel. And unfortunately, they lost control of this experiment, and when things got out of control, ultimately it caused the cataclysmic event or destruction of Atlantis, the 10 islands of Atlantis, and in addition to which, it ripped a series of holes through a number of dimensions, and ultimately that's what caused the problems that occurred in and throughout the Moorish Empire from that time up until the present. So as to questions about the decline of the Moorish Empire, you then again have to go back to these events, these experiments that they were conducting in Atlantis. And so when the time or the time machine experiment got out of control.
Whoa.
As I said, it ripped holes in the dimension. And so consequently, it also caused an axis or planetary axis shift. And when the planetary axis shift occurred, it literally affected everything on the planet, including human memory or human memory retention, because human memory is largely dependent on magnetic fields. And the magnetic field of the Earth literally collapsed and was affected because of the planetary axis shift. And as I said,
and if you're not on a planet, I mean, you know, we got to figure this out, right? So we're just talking about for a minute. All right, all right, all right. Let's get back into the etymology. If we're not on a planet, then there is no axis. So whatever shift we're talking about is literally a spirit of stupor, literally a conscious situation, a consciousness shift of stupor. Because we're only talking planets, right? I mean, we're only talking Mars, right? But if Mars is a planet, then Mars is a planetai, a wandering star. So you're saying you came from a wandering star? A star, not a land, a star, a wandering star to wander. So Moors are on Mars, wandering. They're in a wandering frequency in the celestial, trapped in the underworld underneath the firmament of uncertain etymology, possibly the Pai Pele flat. So their definition is flat, to spread out. Flat. Planet's definition is a flat, spread out surface, yo. But the semantics are highly problematic. The meaning strongly recalls plaisir, to make devious. Treacherous Templars, to make devious from Mars, to make devious, repel, dissuade from the right path. So if their energy is going to Baal, Baal, Bay and El, Baal, the Canaanite gods, the Canaanite fallen angels, if it's going to Inki and Enlil, if it's going to whatever we're talking about, the Queen Mother, whatever little celestial situation we're talking about, it is devious, repelling and dissuading from the right path. Bewilder, wandering star, planet, plane, flat. All we're talking about is flat. So what is this axis shift on a flat surface? Well, you have to dig on the etymology of planet. What is it really going down? What devious situation is this Atlantean hyper jump of these Moors opening acts, you know, opening portals and doing this? What are they doing today? Opening portals. So they were opening portals in, destroying where? America. America, Guatemala, whatever you want to call it.
Also because of this particular experiment that they were conducting.
Uh-huh.
And so, after this occurred, or after this time, you had many of the ascended masters from the sixth dimension who came back to Earth to assist the Moors that dispersed over various parts of the planet, of the globe.
And when you hear ascended masters, you're talking about the same spirit science. Go back to the spirit science drop. He's saying the same damn thing as spirit science. Ascended masters. What does that sound like? Dweller, Lucifer, Thoth, Emerald Tablets, frequency. He's under the Thoth frequency right now. Love to the brother, but we are throwing all of this, you know what I'm saying, in the air. We're waving it like we just don't care. We're being Drop Nation. We're putting our frequency all up on you. We're not letting you put your frequency all up on us. What order do you serve?
In Kemet, in the Americas and many other places, Peru, etc.
Peru?
And so in order to assist the Moors, What they did was that they started a process known as stair-step evolution. Because the Moors at that time from Atlantis had literally gone back into a state of Berberism or so-called barbarism.
Barbaria.
And they had lost a lot of the information, the sciences, etc., that they had once learned or mastered in Atlantis. And so through a series of...
But listen. Hey, remember, you came here for the interruption. I'll drop the link. You can watch this interruption free. But now it's coming through me. Nah. So Barbaria, so, you know, he's saying that they fell in this state. But Thoth just told you that he came over here, hijacked you in a frequency, and put a magic science spell upon you. This is what happened. You got hijacked by an energy. You didn't fall from the state of Atlantis. They are the sons of Atlantis. And they put a frequency that had you cowering and groveling at their feet. These ascended masters of so-called Egypt.
Of instructions, these ascended masters in what was known as the Tap Brotherhood, they would, through the stair-step evolutionary process, they would instruct these Moors in different areas of sciences in hopes that they would regain or recall much of what was lost. Unfortunately, such was not the case. It didn't really take. And so, unfortunately, thereafter you had a downward spiral that occurred. And thus, this is what brought in another experiment, but one of which was, or proved to be, a positive experiment in the creation of the ancient pharaoh known as Akhenaten, or some known as Akhenaten. And anyway, Akhenaten was an immortal being who was created, and for the sole purpose of introducing what is known as Una Mens consciousness, or one mind or unity consciousness. And it was basically to bring the Moors to another level of consciousness, these Moors in particular, as I said, in Atlantis, who had lost a lot of their memory and the sciences. And so, in attempting to introduce the Una Mens consciousness, they did this through establishing what later became known as the ancient mystery system of Kemet, which actually stemmed from the Nakal Mystery School of Atlantis. And in these schools,
man, we gonna, you know, in part two or three, bring out the spirit science again. So you hear he's really, I mean, it's, you know, literally word for word of what spirit science is kicking. And that's the, you know what I'm saying, the whole new age, you know what I'm saying, connection. But see how this is connecting here. So spirit science is rocking hand by hand with this history here. The Nurkals, the Ascended Masters, these Martians coming over, hijacking, da-da-da. Wow. So what, you know what I'm saying, after all this goes down, after these Ascended Masters are now, you know, saying, oh, we got to raise up your frequency from all of this and this and this, where is the Creator? Where is the Creator with these Ascended Masters? Where is the Creator with all this history? He hasn't mentioned the Creator one time. Is there no Creator? Is the Creator have no involvement with what's happening in Atlantis and these Ascended Masters? Or is his praise going to the Ascended Masters who took them out of this lower vibration? Is that what Thoth told you?
They instructed many of the Moors in many of the high sciences, breathing techniques, as I said, language tones or tones and of languages of light.
Thoth taught you writing, but you didn't need it when you were telepathic. They gave you pyramids, but you didn't need them when you had sacred trees.
So as to raise their consciousness, to bring them in harmony with the grids. As a matter of fact, just backtracking a little, when the magnetic field collapsed back in Atlantis, or during the time of Atlantis, ultimately what happened was that not only did it affect the human memory, but it also affected the grids. And so what these ascended masters had to do was that they had to actually plug into the grid consciousness of the planet, the logarithmic spiral grids of the planet. And
they hijacked the grid. They're saying they did it to raise your consciousness. They say they did it to raise your vibration. But take it back to the Emerald Tablets of Thought. That's all we're talking about. Long dwelt we in the land of Kim, long and yet long again, until obeying the commands of the Master, who while sleeping yet lives eternally, I sent for me the sons of Atlantis, sent them in many directions, that from the womb of time wisdom might rise again in her children. I want them to remember. These sons of Atlantis, the children of Atlantis, I want you to remember. The Creator destroyed everything we did, but I want you to remember the might of the hijack, the might of the celestial, the might of those dissuading you, and the wandering star dissuading you from the right path, perplexing you with magic science, groveling. I release them. Cowered I them by my display of magic science. Upward grew into the light of knowledge. The children of Kim watered by the rain of my wisdom. So that's what he's saying, that this Kemet was raised up by Atlantis. He's telling you that. But it's all here. And it's a story that's happened with Atlantis. Weird. Here, all of this, Atlantis is a plural, meaning multiple continents. It's not just this one. It's all of these westward continents. And again, west is east and east is west. But again, we're just talking about Atlantis. Great grew the sons of Kim, conquered the people around them. So these people were hijacked in magic science. These people were hypnotized in a slave vibration, a ray of vibration, a ray of vibration. Then raised I my staff and directed a ray of vibration, striking them still in their tracks as fragments of stone of the mountain. And why? And then telling them of the might of Atlantis when you were, you know, as a fragment of a stone in the mountain. Then grew the sons of Kim, conquering the people around them, growing slowly upwards in soul force. All these ascended masters taught us more as this. They taught us the sciences. They taught us to write. Wasn't Thoth the scribe? Wasn't he the scribe, the magician? He's describing Thoth teaching the more. He's describing them, teaching them how to grow and conquer the people around them. Great grew the sons of Kim, conquering the people around them. Barbaria, right? Barbaria, right? Barbary, right? We went into a state of Barbary. Barbaria, Kim, growing slowly upward in soul force, conquering the people around them. Now for a time I go among them into the dark hall of Amenti. Is this Noah? Did Noah go into the dark hall of Amenti? Deep in the hall of the earth, before the lords of the powers, face to face once again with the dweller. So again, this is clear. We're not talking about the Creator. He went deep into the halls of Amenti, deep into the hall of the earth. He went low to go face to face with that dwells there, the dweller, their master, that which this Uriel Bey is calling his ascended master, teaching them magic sciences. Oh, bringing them into high consciousness from Atlantis. Atlantis was just destroyed. Now, for a time I go from among them. So Thoth left them. Muhammad left them. Into the dark halls of Amenti, deep in the halls of the earth, before the lords of the powers, face to face once again with the dweller. Oh, great grew the sons of Kim, conquering the people around them. You're not representing the indigenous, you're representing that which conquered the indigenous. The colonies of Morocco, Morocco. Oh, all in the name of Atlantis, all in the name of their access consciousness. They hijacked your grids with pyramids. They hijacked your grids with everything, all your sacred energy. Let's go.
And various parts or key positions of the earth in order to, again, assist these Moors in helping to raise your consciousness. And so when we look at these different techniques involving the languages, the tones of the languages, etc., in particular ancient languages that you'll find, like, for example, in the ancient Moabite, the Aramaic, many of the Kemetic languages, tones, etc.
One more time.
Magnetic field collapsed these Moors in helping to raise your consciousness. And so when we look at these different techniques involving the languages, the tones of the languages, etc., in particular ancient languages that you'll find, like, for example, in the ancient Moabite.
Ancient Moabite. So the first thing he names is Moabite. That's why Islam, Muhammad, Baphomet, Sultan. None of this is what you are. None of this is what you are rocking with. My indigenous Negro, Hebrew, sons of Eberu. You gonna name Moabite before Hebrew? Before, really? So they are rocking and representing for who? For what?
The languages, the tones of the languages, etc., in particular ancient languages that you'll find, like, for example, in the ancient Moabite,
bang,
the Aramaic, many of the Kemetic languages, tones, etc. The one thing of which I find to be very interesting,
no,
that
Hebrew,
most people don't touch on, even for those that deal with etymology, is that when you're talking about these particular ancient languages and these tones that help to respatialize the organism so as to raise the harmonic level of the body and consciousness on a whole, is that these languages are actually alkaline-based languages. Now, I know we think of, you know, alkaline in terms of, you know, foods, different types of foods we eat, etc., but these particular languages were alkaline-based as opposed to the acidic dialects and languages that we use today. As, for example, not so much the English language. So don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with the English language per se, because it was actually one of many languages that was created by the Moors. It's just that...
English language was one of many languages created by the Moors, the forked tongue that has you reading from left to right, not right to left, that has reversed your entire consciousness. He's talking about an axis consciousness grid change. English is a motherfucking axis consciousness grid change. He's talking about the importance of the tonal languages, and then he goes into, we created English. Well, why did you create English more? Why are we speaking English today more if you created English more? There's nothing wrong with English, you say? Oh, my people, there's nothing wrong with English, you say?
In terms of, you know, foods, different types of foods we eat, etc. But these particular languages were alkaline-based as opposed to the acidic.
So alkaline versus acidic. So Moabite, you're saying, is alkaline, or Hebrew would be alkaline. So what would be acidic? If it's not English, what language is acidic?
Dialects and languages that we use today. As, for example, not so much the English language. So don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with the English language,
wow,
per se, because it was actually one of many languages that was created by the Moors.
Bang.
It's just that the modern Albion, so-called English, European dialect that we've adopted is the problem. And this particular dialect is acidic and also electrical, as opposed to the alkaline based languages of which I'm talking about, which are also,
I want to hear a dialect of alkaline English. I'll wait.
Or highly magnetic. And so again, when we look at these particular languages, that I mentioned, they actually feed the melanin. In addition to raising the consciousness, and they're high resonating, they're also carbon and silicon based, which are two of perhaps two of the most unique elements on the periodic table of elements. And so the carbon and silicon-based languages that again feed the melanin, I should also include in that list Moorish Latin or ancient Moorish Latin. Now, all of these ancient tonal patterns actually mimic the pattern of melanin. And as I said, as opposed to the acidic electrical dialect that we're using in the so-called English language, and which, by the way, when I say acids, I mean infectious or an infectious saturation of acids of the blood and bones. And this is symptomatic of what is known as cretinism. Now, many of you know that the definition of Christian is Cretan, and Cretan is Christian.
Wow.
But now if we take it a step further, we look at cretinism, and cretinism is actually a form of Mike's edema. Mike's edema is basically an underactive thyroid, or an underactive thyroid gland known as hypothyroidism, or Hashimoto's thyroiditis, which basically is a poor binding process of iodine to a group of amino acids of a glycoprotein made in the thyroid gland. And these amino acids are tyrosine residues,